In this video, we're going to review the corneal collagen crosslinking treatment for keratoconus. To do this, we're going to head over to meet with one of the world's leading corneal surgeons for this procedure, Dr. Mark Lobanoff of OVO Lasik and Lens, where we can break down how corneal crosslinking works, what the procedure looks like from both the doctor's and the patient's perspective, as well as answering some of the most common questions about the crosslinking procedure. So blink your eyes a few times, hit that like button, and let's take a look. Hello and welcome. This is Dr. Joseph Allen here from the Dr. Eye Health Show, and I'm super excited today because we're here at OVO Lasik and Lens, the home base of Dr. Mark Lobanoff, a world-renowned corneal specialist and surgeon who specializes in all forms of refractive surgery, including LASIK, specialized cataract surgery, ICL implants, and corneal collagen crosslinking for keratoconus, which we're going to be talking about today. So again, huge honor for me. Thank you, Dr. Lobanoff. How are you doing today?
I am doing fantastic. Thank you for coming to visit us. We really appreciate it.
Dr. Lobanoff, you've been working with so many patients for so long with corneal collagen crosslinking. In your own words, would you mind sharing with our viewers what is corneal collagen crosslinking and how does it work?
So I had trained in a cornea fellowship and my specialty was cornea. And for years, we were treating keratoconus with corneal transplantation. And it worked, but it's a big surgery. And suddenly we started hearing from our European colleagues that there's a new treatment, a new way of halting the progression of the disease called corneal crosslinking. And for over a decade, we were jealous because suddenly they had this new technology to really treat this disease in a non-surgical way, or less invasive way, and halt the progression of that disease. Finally, it came to the United States, and so we have this here. Corneal crosslinking fixes the defect in the cornea. So in keratoconus, patients have a cornea that has become weakened. It's become thinned, and there's a weakness in the structure of that tissue. And as it becomes weaker and thinner, it bulges outward into a cone. And by bulging forward, it really creates an irregular surface and distorts the vision. Suddenly glasses don't work, soft contacts don't work anymore. And patients really struggle more and more with their vision. So the concept behind crosslinking is to take that weak cornea and make it stronger, form new chemical bonds between the fibers within that cornea, strengthening it, halting the disease, stopping it.
Now, what's really cool about crosslinking is that there's always new inventions, new ways to do things. And one of the reasons we're here with Dr. Lobanoff is because he is one of the leading surgeons in the world creating new parts of this procedure to really help patients. So let us know, Dr. Lobanoff, what are you doing differently when it comes to crosslinking?
So for the crosslinking procedure itself, again, keratoconus, cone on the cornea. And if you think about it, we want to apply riboflavin, vitamin solution. We want to saturate that cornea. The weakest part of a cornea with keratoconus is the tip of the cone. So traditionally, you put the drop on, and the drop would roll off that cone. So the part of the cornea you want to have the riboflavin the most has it for the least amount of time. So I said, we can improve upon this. And so I built a device, and it's a silicone well that sits on the cornea, and you can submerge the entire cone and the whole cornea in the riboflavin. And this way, you can saturate the cornea in about 1/3 of the time, so 10 minutes instead of 30, and you know that critical cone is getting the adequate riboflavin. So that's one change. This device is undergoing evolution, and one of the things that limits the reaction for crosslinking is oxygen. And so as we apply the ultraviolet light and it starts triggering the crosslinks, it uses up the oxygen in the cornea really fast. So the next iteration of this device is going to be able to pump in 100% pure oxygen while the ultraviolet light is being applied to help improve that crosslinking reaction. So that's coming as well.
Wow. And that's just amazing. Again, you're pushing the envelope and really like changing the future of treatment for keratoconus.
Another big part of this is the beauty of crosslinking is it stops the disease process, it halts it. But if all we do is crosslink, we have left the cornea in this abnormal shape. So the other area of research that I have is topography guided PRK. using topography guided PRK to fix this mountain, fix this cone with a laser, and then lock that in place with the crosslinking. We've been doing this for about 6 years now. 100% of our patients show improvement in uncorrected and corrected vision with this. So we're very excited about it.
So this is more or less not just a way to slow down and halt the progression of keratoconus, but you are finding a way to enhance someone's vision.
Roll back the damage, restore clarity to vision, get this eye to see clearly once again. And so patients are ecstatic that they can say, not only can I stop my disease, but I can see better again. That's a really powerful thing to offer.
Well, amazing at what you're doing. Again, huge honor to be here with you. So this is cool. Thank you guys. Now, next up is that we have a patient here that's going to be getting the crosslinking procedure done, and he's volunteered to let us videotape it. And so Dr. Lobanoff is gonna walk us through some of the major steps of the procedure so that if you, a friend or a family member is having this procedure, you know what to expect.
All right, so the first thing we're gonna do is we're gonna apply some numbing drops. We wanna make sure you are as comfortable as possible. And we'll let these soak in. Our next step, we're gonna gently move the eyelashes out of the way. And then this device here, you're gonna feel a little gentle pressure on the lids. This gives us a little space to work in. Now what we're gonna be doing is we're gonna be applying the riboflavin, and we wanna saturate the cornea with the riboflavin. So this device is gonna be applying a little bit of pressure, very light, and we'll be having this in place now here for a while. So we'll have a countdown for you. So we've let the riboflavin sit in place here for 10 minutes. The cornea is fully saturated. We've got this great yellow saturation glow that we're looking for. Now the critical step is applying the ultraviolet light. And it's the ultraviolet light here that's going to trigger the chemical reaction that we want. So right above you is a greenish looking light. We're gonna be setting this into position. We'll just have you continue to watch this light, and there'll be a timer as we count down for this. All right, we've just finished the application of the ultraviolet light. We're gonna put in a few drops for you, put on a contact lens so that you're more comfortable as you heal, and congratulations, you've done a great job.
All right, so now after the procedure, we know so many of you are gonna have a lot of common questions as we get them all the time, but let's just run through some of the common Q&A that we often get. So one of the biggest ones here is first, like how long of a procedure is crosslinking? What is it gonna be like sitting there? Typically, how long does it take?
So typically crosslinking will take about an hour. And the first step is saturating the cornea with a vitamin solution called riboflavin. Mm-hmm. And then once that cornea is saturated with the riboflavin, the second step is applying ultraviolet light. And so here in the United States, typically patients can count on being in the room for about an hour.
Is it always done with both eyes? Do you ever do just one eye?
I usually do one eye, and here's why. When I first began doing this, I was really excited, patients were excited, I did both eyes, not realizing that there is a recovery period, and vision can be very blurry for the first 1 to 2 weeks. If you do that to both eyes, you're really out of commission. You can't see your phone, you can't watch TV, you can't drive. And so what we realize is most patients prefer to have one eye done. We treat the eye, we let them heal, let them recover their vision, and then when the patient says, you know what, I'm ready, then we tackle the second eye.
That's perfect, because that also answers that next question of like, what will vision afterward be like? So it's gonna be a little blurry for a few weeks.
It's important to set that expectation. We are performing a procedure that is strengthening the cornea, we're stopping a disease, but it also means because of that treatment, vision's very blurry the first 2 weeks. You just have to bite the bullet and know, yep, my vision's gonna be very blurry while it heals during the first 2 weeks. And then we turn the corner and vision begins improving again.
So I know a lot of people will ask me like, okay, am I gonna be on medications afterward? Am I using just eye drops? What kind of medications are they gonna be using after the procedure?
So we start with over-the-counter ibuprofen, and we use a fairly good dose of that, 800 milligrams to begin with, and then come down to about 600 milligrams, taper down to 400 milligrams. We also give prescription pain meds for the first 2 days. We know these patients, without that pain medication, there's a chance they're gonna be in pain. We don't want our patients to suffer. We will cover that pain. We want them to know and rest assured we've got their back. Beyond the first 2 days though, they really don't need that. And over-the-counter pain medications take care of that. We also use prescription drops. So patients are on a mixture of drops, some antibiotics to prevent infection, steroids to prevent inflammation, and that also helps with some of the discomfort. Sometimes we'll use a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory like ketorolac drops. And then good old artificial tears, just keeping things hydrated.
Now, some people do ask, you know, what are the complications? What are the risks? Is there anything that could go wrong, anything like that in your experience?
Fortunately, the risks seem to be pretty low, but this is a procedure, and some of the risks that you might want to think about is you can create some corneal haze. So we're taking corneal fibers, and we're creating chemical bonds between those fibers, and as the bonds become stronger, they pull the fibers closer together. In some patients, that can create some haze in the cornea. Fortunately, it's pretty mild. Most patients don't know they even have it, but in certain cases, it can be more intense. We're always worried about infection, and that's why we're providing the antibiotics, trying to prevent infection. But it's important for patients to also take control of that too. So making sure they're in a clean environment. The first week is probably not the best time to clean out a dirty garage or a dirty barn. You want to avoid dust and dirt. You want to help your eye heal.
Now, I know this is a tough question, but as far as a coverage for this procedure, some insurances are now covering this. What's your experience been like?
It was really difficult in the early days because this was new to insurance companies. They didn't know exactly how to deal with it. Now it's more commonplace. So I would say the majority of insurance carriers now do cover this. It is a medical condition. It helps prevent the progression of a really severe disease and really helps us head off needing something as large as a corneal transplant. So I think if you are interested in this and you've got insurance, one of the good things is that most insurance companies will cover it. I'd say work with your surgeon, determine what the cost is in your part of the country, work with your insurance carrier, and fortunately, we have good coverage for this now.
Now, of course, we know that we can't address all of your questions right now, but let us know in the comments section if you do have any questions about the procedure, just your own experience, or if anybody else has already had the procedure, let us know in the comments, because this is a good way to get connected with other people that are dealing with keratoconus and are interested in corneal crosslinking. Otherwise, a huge thank you to you, Dr. Lobanoff, your staff, our patient today. Again, can't say thank you enough for just helping us out and all of your services.
It's our pleasure. We're really passionate about this procedure. It helps so many patients, and you helping get the word out is tremendous. So thank you.
Now remember, the corneal collagen crosslinking procedure is really meant to slow down and halt the progression of keratoconus. And depending on somebody's condition, how advanced the keratoconus is, there may be different options for vision correction. To understand what options are out there or what may work for you, check out our next video in the series breaking down all of those vision correction options, everything from contact lenses to glasses, even surgical procedures. So to learn more about that, click or tap the screen over here to the side or check out the videos in our YouTube playlist below in the description. Otherwise, again, thanks for watching. Keep an eye on it, and we'll talk to you soon.